We'll move on to the next item of business, which is a ministerial, which is a statement by Shirley Ann Somerville on education reform update. I'll allow a moment or two for front benches to reorganise. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Shirley Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to update Parliament on the Scottish Government's Education Reform and Improvement Agenda. I'll cover a number of areas today, including our forthcoming national discussion on the vision for Scottish education, the creation of three new national education bodies, the independent review of qualifications and assessment that Professor Louise Hayward has been asked to lead, and the development of a set of purpose and principles for the post-school education research and skills system. Like education systems across the world, the Scottish education system has been tested by the pandemic. In many ways, it has shown itself to be resilient, creative and adaptive. But the pandemic has presented big challenges, and it is right, therefore, that we collectively take this opportunity to reflect and to reform. We start from strong foundations. Scotland is the only part of the UK to offer 1140 funded hours of early learning and childcare to eligible children. Our school pupils are benefiting from more teachers, with teacher numbers at their highest since 2008 and the highest per pupil of any UK country. Over 93% of school leavers in education, employment or training are progressing onto positive destinations. On tackling the attainment gap, we are making good progress too, with our record 16.7% of university entrants coming from SIMD 20 backgrounds in 2021. Scotland has a highly educated population and has the highest proportion of adults with tertiary level education in the UK. At the heart of our reform programme is pride in the skills, the talent and commitment in our education system today, with a recognition that we cannot stand still and change is needed, however, and that reform is necessary as we look to the future. That is a message in Professor Ken Muir's report and one which we hear from across the sector. I have made clear my determination to deliver change. This is something that government cannot and should not deliver alone. Professor Muir highlights in his report that education policy and services are best developed when they are informed by the practice and the experience of those who use and deliver them at every level. We want to bring the widest possible range of voices and views into the room. As I'm sure the Chamber will agree, it is our children and young people who hold the biggest stake in our education system, and I'm determined that they will be heard just as strongly across our reform programme as they were in Professor Muir's report. We know the incredible work teachers, school staff and practitioners do to support learners, and we will continue to draw on that experience and expertise through our engagement with professional associations and more widely. We will be proactive in engaging with all those who have a stake in the continued success of our education system. Delivery partners, trade unions, equality and human rights organisations, Gaelic, medium and Scots language sectors, practitioners working at every level, employers, the youth work sector, parents and carers, the representative organisations and indeed wider communities. It is also important that the agenda for education reform is far-reaching, covering the span of our lifelong learning journey. Presiding Officer, I have committed the Scottish Government to holding a national discussion to establish a compelling and consensual vision for the future of Scottish education. Those working in the sector and many in this chamber will recall the national debate on education, which was held in 2002. That debate led to the creation of Curriculum for Excellence, a curriculum which last year's OECD independent report found offers an inspiring and widely supported philosophy of education. 2 decades on from the last national debate on Scottish education, the time is right to discuss our vision for the system. This is a discussion for everyone, and I have written today to education spokespeople from all parties in this chamber, inviting them to take part. Professor Muir has challenged all of us to work together to establish a consensual vision for education which can genuinely put the learner at the centre. I sincerely hope that this is a challenge that we all rise to, including today. We might not agree on everything, but that should not stop us from finding common ground. The national discussion will be co-convened by the Scottish Government and our local government partners COSLA and will launch in the new term. Local government is the statutory provider of education, and in any truly national discussion has to be a joint endeavour. I'm grateful to COSLA for their support for the national discussion and look forward to working with them in the coming months. I'm pleased to inform Parliament that Carol Campbell, Professor of Leadership and Educational Change at the Ontario Institute for Studies in Education at the University of Toronto, and Dr. Alma Harris, Emeritus Professor at Swansea University and Professor at Cardiff School of Education and Social Policy, have agreed to co-facilitate the national discussion. Both professors have extensive experience of educational change, leadership and school improvement, as well as a strong understanding of the Scottish education system through their work as members of the International Council of Education Advisers. They are committed to ensuring the discussion engages widely and reflects the views of those who they need to listen to most, our learners. It is by listening carefully to the learners of today that we will build a vision for the education system of the future. We are grateful to the Scottish Youth Parliament for the work they will be doing over the summer to start gathering the views of young people, and we look forward to working with many other organisations and learners as we seek to hold a discussion in which we prioritise listening to those whose voices are seldom heard. I want this to be the most inclusive ever discussion on education, and I also look forward to meeting all the members of the International Council of Education Advisers later this month, who will be able to bring their diverse international perspectives to bear on the opportunities and the challenges for Scotland's education system in a post-pandemic world. Presiding Officer, it is crucial that our reform programme takes this opportunity to reflect, debate and develop what we need, not just now but in the future, for all parts of the learner journey. That is why I asked Professor Louise Hayward to undertake an independent review of qualifications and assessment. As with Professor Ken Muir's work, this process is fully independent, but I can confirm that Professor Hayward has now started the review and is committed to meaningful engagement with all interested parties, not least young people themselves. An independent review group has been established that includes young people and teachers who will now work with their peers to consider options for change. The review will also engage directly with schools and colleges and key partners in learner journey qualifications and assessment. Professor Hayward will report to me by the end of March 2023 and crucially will work closely with the national discussion so that key initial findings from the exercise can be considered ahead of final recommendations on the futures of examinations and assessment. These strands of work will also connect into and inform the development of the purpose and principles for our post-school education research and skills ecosystem. The development of the purpose and principles is an opportunity to stimulate debate, challenge perceptions and further develop a shared evidence base on what the post-school ecosystem delivers for Scotland, aligning our efforts and decisions to deliver the outcomes we want to see. Presiding Officer, I have spoken about our commitment to designing and delivering real change and of bringing wide and diverse voices into the conversation. And that will also be reflected in how we create a new qualifications body, a new national agency for Scottish education and an independent inspectorate body. These bodies will replace the Scottish Qualifications Authority and Education Scotland. Design and delivery of the new bodies will be informed by engagement with a broad spectrum of those with a stake in their success and underpinned by determination to bring in external views and innovative ideas that test, challenge and embed new approaches, cultures, governance and accountabilities and ways of working. I have ensured that Professors Ken Muir and Louise Hayward have key roles in these arrangements to provide ongoing strategic and external support and critical challenge. I will also be ensuring that a number of external individuals sit at the very centre of that work that is now starting to design the new bodies, to provide that critical challenge we know will be needed to achieve real change and reform of the system. Building on the foundations laid by Professor Muir's extensive engagement, a stakeholder reference group will shortly be established, which I will chair, and we will also be looking to draw on the approach taken by Social Security Scotland through their experience panels, so that as broad a range of people with an interest in education can have a say in the design of processes and services for the new bodies. But I would emphasise to Parliament that overall accountability and responsibility for the reform programme will be with the Scottish Government and ultimately with me as Cabinet Secretary. I have been clear and unambiguous in setting out my desire for substantive change and meaningful reform, with children and young people, families, teachers and practitioners playing a key part in that decision-making. Staff in Education Scotland and the SQA deserve our thanks for continuing to deliver for Scotland's learners, including successful delivery of exams over the past 2 months, and we will ensure that the knowledge, expertise and experience contributes to that reform process. I spoke earlier about the importance of early learning and childcare, and we are committed to ensuring that inspection of early learning and childcare supports delivery of high-quality services and ensures appropriate scrutiny. But we need to remove unnecessary burdens and duplications. We welcome Professor Muir's recommendations that there should be a shared inspection framework for early learning and childcare settings developed by the Care Inspectorate and the New Education Inspectorate. We will come forward with specific programmes proposals to consult the sector shortly, followed by a programme of engagement over the summer and autumn. I'm working with Her Majesty's Chief Inspector of Education and the Chief Executive of the Care Inspectorate to identify what they can do in partnership from the start of the next academic year to streamline and improve the inspection process for providers. Presiding Officer, each of the areas I have updated on today will be developed through joint working in the weeks and months to come. It will be a discussion and a journey for everyone, with a stake in the continued success of Scottish education, and I look forward to continuing to work constructively with members and others on our reform ambitions.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues around the issues that have been raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. And I would be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is not education reform. It's more of the same with a different name. While standards continue to slip and our young people are let down, this government does not very much at all. Professor Walter Humes sums it up, doesn't he? Boards populated by the usual suspects, including senior staff from the bodies which are to be replaced. He says it sounds like insider dealing, with those who are part of the problem being tasked with producing the solutions. He's right, isn't he? And Cabinet Secretary, you and the First Minister are part of the problem, aren't you?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, those remarks that have been referred to were of course made before I made the statement and before we've made any announcements about the governance of the process. But what I would say to anyone who still has a doubt about my ambitions for change in this area, I came in very early into this post and set out very early my determination for that reform process. I came to education from another position within the Scottish Government that has moved a system that was unpopular and people had concerns over, and we have developed from that a social security system, delivered real change that is now respected across Scotland. The Government has, and I have, a history of delivering real change. That is exactly what I'm determined to do. So I appreciate that people will be concerned that this is not a complete progress, process of reform. I think I've made very clearly why that is not the case. This programme will be overseen by ministers. Yes, it will be delivered, of course, by Scottish Government officials. I've spoken in my statement about the importance of the critical friends and the critical contacts we will have in that process. Nothing will prevent change from happening.
Michael Mara.
Presiding Officer, I hope the Cabinet Secretary would appreciate the frustration of the Chamber at the interminable delays. She talks about real change, but nothing has actually changed. We have more and more groups talking about change. I mean, if the Cabinet Secretary wanted to send an invitation to join a group, she could have picked up the phone. She didn't have to have a statement to Parliament to do it, because there's really precious little else in this statement we did not already know. It confirms once again only the glacial pace of reform. We're 8 months on from Professor Hayward being appointed. Could we not expect today, at the very least, maybe an interim report? When on earth will the actual report be published? This is not delay without cost or consequence. A generation of young Scots, presiding officer, are failed by this government and debilitated by the pandemic, and they're being left without solution or redress, and that is entirely unacceptable. It is good to have today confirmed that Education Scotland is going to go. Has the Cabinet Secretary written a letter to the leaders of that organisation today as well? Because only days ago, the Education Committee was told the body was not being scrapped and that for years to come it was going to be, and I quote, business as usual. And business as usual, presiding officer, is of course the problem. Savage yearly cuts in schools, colleges and universities, or the post-school ecosystem, as civil service would have it called. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that any discussion of reform must be accompanied by an acknowledgement of these cuts and a commitment to resource our education system properly?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I look forward to Scottish Labour actually bringing through costed proposals at the next budget. I may have a long wait, presiding officer, because they don't actually do that. They simply make statements in Parliament and then do not back that up about how actually anything will be resourced. And that is the difference between being in opposition with no hope of being in government and actually being government itself. Business as usual is important because until the new organisations are established, of course they will continue to deliver support for teachers and deliver exams. So business as usual is not to be mocked and is not to be sidelined. It's actually to be encouraged and to be supported to ensure that our children and young people are still supported through this process. We talk about the need for speed in this issue, and yes, there is a need for improvement in this. That's exactly why the Scottish Government has delivered already 2,000 additional teachers from pre-pandemic levels and have committed to £1 billion worth of expenditure. But when we look at a longer-term reform progress, it is important that we do that, not just as a government, but that we do that in a wide way that encourages a great conversation and a discussion about what needs to happen. And that's exactly why we have and will set up facilitation work with the Scottish Youth Parliament, facilitation work with our teachers and the stakeholder groups to ensure that they are hearing from each other, and that is getting directly to me. And Professor Louise Hayward is independent of government. She has been working, I think, exceptionally well with those in the education system to develop, I think, quite an innovative approach to how she's going to be delivering her report. She is keen to work with the national discussion because it is important that she does respond after that, because I don't want to get in a position where what is decided for qualifications actually tilts what we do in the rest of the education progress. That is exactly why this reform process is something which has been worked on closely right across the education system. And I hope, despite the questions today, Michael Mara will take part in that.
Co-Cab Stewart, to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, presiding officer. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's update and the next crucial stage of reform set out today, especially the commitment to put the voices of our young people at the heart. The Cabinet Secretary will agree with me, however, that we must provide assurances to learners that this process will deliver real change and meaningful change. What assurances can the Cabinet Secretary provide of her personal commitment to deliver just that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've made very clear, both in my initial statement and to Oliver Mundell, that I am absolutely determined to deliver real change in the education system. How we will do that as a government is to work, yes, right across government, but to engage with practitioners and learners, those who deliver and use education, and those who have differing views, indeed, from the Scottish Government, to ensure that those views are being heard right at the centre of the reform progress. I think what we have set up, both for the national discussion and for the reform and replacement of the organisations and qualifications, is an example of that. Learning from what's worked well in other parts of government, for example, around social security, about ensuring that we are using a wide range of partners, not just perhaps the usual suspects that you would see around the table in a discussion around education, but reaching out as extensively as we possibly can. And I gave the example of the user panels as one of that. I think there is a real opportunity for real change, and that's exactly what I'm determined to deliver.
Megan Gallagher, to be followed by Graham Day.
Thank you, presiding officer. This is another education statement that has a lot of words but no direct action. We have commitments from the Cabinet Secretary today that will create more levels of bureaucracy, and we have yet to see any meaningful change. Call me cynical, but why has this statement been brought forward to today? Is this just a ploy to deflect attention from the Scottish Government's desperate attempt to kickstart a new independence referendum campaign?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Megan Gallagher will know that it is not the job of the Government, and particularly not me, to set the Parliament timetable, and therefore this has been important that we get a statement on Scottish education. Now, I am normally criticised for not doing debates on Scottish education and not doing statements, but somehow we're being criticised to actually bring them today. What Megan Gallagher calls democracy, I call consultation. I think that is what people are looking to see. I think what came very strongly through in Ken Muir's report is about consultation and about listening to young people. And I'm afraid Michael Marr is not even listening to my response, never mind to children, young people and teachers, presiding officer. But there is a consultation that is required. It came very strongly through in Professor Muir's work. It was his first recommendation that he gave to government. I'm determined to take that on. I don't see any response from the opposition parties that would suggest they're rising to the challenge so far.
Graham Day, to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think any reasonable person would welcome the Cabinet Secretary's invitation to opposition parties to play a hopefully constructive role in the reform programme process. But I wonder if she might provide a little further detail on the robust and credible nature of the external challenge regime that she's envisaging here.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think this is one of the most important aspects of the reform programme, is inviting that critical challenge right at the heart of the reform process. I've spoken about the stakeholder reference group, which I will chair, which will ensure that a wide range of stakeholders have a direct ability to have discussions with me about areas of hope, areas of concern, and ensure that that is a core and central part of the reform process. I hope also that there is reassurance given to those in the sector about the role that we have offered to Professor Ken Muir and Professor Louise Hayward within the programme to provide that critical challenge as well. I think particularly Professor Ken Muir's work that is already reported, it has been widely acknowledged to have landed well and has presented, yes, the education sector with challenges, but a lot of hope for the future. There is a great deal we can also do in the national discussion, and I've mentioned the co-facilitators that we've had in an attempt to take the politics out of the discussion, as has been suggested, for example, by the speech from the outgoing Secretary of the EIS, Larry Flanagan, who asked us to attempt to take the politics out of a debate on the education system. I hope the national discussion, co-chaired by COSLA, but facilitated by two external experts, will be another way to ensure that we do just that.
Paul O'Kane, to be followed by Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With a rising attainment gap, lower levels of attainment funding, and an organisation leading our assessments, which the Cabinet Secretary has deemed not fit for purpose, although apparently we shouldn't criticise business as usual, isn't she disappointed and frustrated at her own lack of pace to implement these reforms? Reforms, of course, which will now seek to undo the damage of the SNP's previous reforms since 2007, of which there are too many to list.
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, what we have seen is an increased funding into attainment with £1 billion in this parliamentary term compared to £750 million in the last parliamentary term. And we were seeing improvement with the attainment gap pre-pandemic, although clearly the pandemic will have presented Scotland, as indeed education systems right across the world, with certain challenges, but that's exactly why we have provided that additional funding for the attainment challenge funding, and we are providing more teachers, the commitment to have 3,500 teachers by the end of the parliamentary term, and as I mentioned earlier, 2,000 extra teachers more than pre-pandemic levels.
Ruth McGuire, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Presiding Officer, it's learners the reformed system of education outlined by the Cabinet Secretary needs to serve. Children and young people must be centred in this process. How will the Scottish Government ensure that that happens?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I will be meeting directly with a group of children and young people in the first of a series of engagement sessions very soon to hear directly from them about their priorities for education. And this is the first in a series of moves that we are making within education to shift that power balance to enable learners to be fully centred to the development of the reform progress. I mentioned within my statement the important work that we will be carrying out, facilitated by the Scottish Youth Parliament, to undertake. They will be undertaking an open discussion at the forthcoming summer sitting to ask young people about how this national discussion should be shaped. And of course, Professor Hayward also has two MSYPs working on her independent review group. I hope that gives Ruth Maguire some examples, just some examples, of how we are putting young people at the heart of this process.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
Within the last few days, the Education Secretary's speech to the EIS was described as pathetically weak by their new General Secretary. The Education Secretary was humiliated by the First Minister on the date for closing the poverty-related attainment gap. And the Education Secretary has broken her promise to have a qualified nursery teacher in every deprived community. With that record, what confidence can we have for the chances of real change on reform?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I welcomed my discussions with the new General Secretary for the EIS, as I did enjoy my discussions with the previous General Secretary. I'm sure those will continue on many issues. Some we will agree on and some we won't. But I think we do have a shared endeavour, and I think it is wider than just the Scottish Government and the EIS, to be able to have a discussion about reform for education and the replacement of our organisations. Of course, there has been no change and will be no change with the policy on the removal of the attainment gap. Mr Rennie and others may wish to misinterpret it, misconstrue an attempt to have a division between myself and the First Minister. There is none, there will be none, and we are determined to fulfil our pledges that we had in the programme for government.
Siobhan Brown to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We need to make sure that we hear from the people who know our pupils and our education best, the education system best, our teachers. Can I ask what opportunities teachers will have to shape Scotland's reformed education system through the process outlined by the Cabinet Secretary today?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, they will very much be at the heart of the system of reform, along with young people. I will again mention the stakeholder reference group, which they will play an important part in. I mentioned earlier as well that we are looking and giving further thought to those who we can involve directly on the delivery boards themselves, and I'm sure teachers will play a role in that. That will also go alongside the work that I continue to do when I meet, for example, the teachers panel, who ensure that I have a direct voice with frontline teachers, which I find exceptionally useful. And again, I think the important example that we've seen in the past in Social Security Scotland about their experience panels is something that I would like to see how we can use within the education reform progress. And of course, that will involve teachers.
Ross Greer to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you. The success of this process will depend on a change in culture as well as a change in structures. One entirely fair point of criticism in recent years has been the hostility by the education agencies, particularly the SQA, to any feedback and constructive criticism. The role of the stakeholder reference group will be key to providing the kind of unvarnished constructive challenge needed to establish that new culture. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how that group will engage directly with the officials designing these new bodies?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think an important aspect around the stakeholder reference group is that it will be chaired by me directly, and I will hear often and frequently from them during the reform process to ensure that they have that direct link, not just to officials, but to ministers directly. Ross Greer's point around culture is exceptionally important. We have to ensure that we not only get the structures correct, but the cultures and values that we want within our education system are absolutely embedded from day one in our new agencies, whether that's the replacement to the SQA or the replacement to Education Scotland, or indeed the new inspectorate. I think the way we can do that is ensure that not just the working group, but also the entirety of the reform programme board process has within its very, very initial discussions and working that discussion around culture and the fact that we cannot move on in any of this unless we ensure that the culture is appropriate within all the replacement organisations.
And Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all want Scotland's education system to compete with the best in the world. How will the Scottish Government ensure that we use this opportunity of reform to learn from the best globally?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think one of the important ways that we can do that is through the facilitators that I have announced today for the national discussion on education, and why we continue to ensure that we have the International Council of Education Advisers, who I can seek their views on. I look forward to meeting them in a few weeks' time, where we can discuss the reform progress. And I would also point out, of course, that we have invited the OECD on a number of occasions to provide us with critical challenge through the reviews of Curriculum for Excellence and through their further reviews that they've carried out. And, of course, importantly, then, we act on their recommendations, which this reform progress, process is a good example of.
And Stephen Kerr.
Officer, on the 18th of May, in the Education, Children and Young People's Committee, I asked the Cabinet Secretary when the attainment gap would be closed. And she said, and I quote, "I will not set an arbitrary date for when the attainment gap will be closed." Those are the very words of the Cabinet Secretary in response to my very open question. When will the gap be closed? I will not set a date. So now the First Minister says it's 2026. I think this Parliament deserves to hear the Cabinet Secretary say here and now that the attainment gap will be closed by 2026, within the lifetime of this Parliament. And will she produce a set of milestones by which we can judge how she is progressing towards the achievement of that objective? Two very simple questions.
Cabinet Secretary.
The discussion that we had within the Education Committee, Presiding Officer, and the discussion that has been had around the First Minister's reflections on the programme for government show that we are all right across government determined to close the attainment gap. Yes, it will have been impacted by the pandemic, but as the programme for government set out in 2016, we are absolutely determined to see that progress that is laid out in that programme for government, that has been laid out in the programme for government of 2026. There has been nothing that has changed from what has been in the programme for government and what has been said by the First Minister on this issue, or indeed any of the discussions that I've had within the Education Committee. We are all, right across government, determined to close the attainment gap, and we will be able to see that. One of the ways we are determined to see the approach taken by local government, because they are directly actually involved and delivering education, is around the stretch aims which we have asked for them to proceed with. That's a new addition to our education system. The local authorities will be developing those stretch aims, and I said at the Education Committee that we will be publishing those. If I am not happy or concerned about the pace of change within that, then of course I will let the Education Committee know. And it is unfortunate, Presiding Officer, through that entire answer, Mr Kerr has refused to actually listen to it, so I perhaps think we will be around this road again, because he is refusing to actually answer, to actually listen to what the Scottish Government is doing, and listen to the work that we're doing with local government to ensure that we are delivering on it.
Thank you. That concludes the Ministerial Statement on Education Reform Update. There will be a very short pause before we move to the next item of business.